Hi, folks. Good evening. Good evening. We're live tonight, and you may pick this up at another different time. But my name is Dr. Richard Michal, and my practice is MDVIP. That stands for MD's Value in Prevention. And our theme over the course of the next few months and has been is prevention. And tonight we're going to talk about something that is very, very, very common, okay? It's a medical disorder, and we are going to have open line. So let your friends know, and we'll begin our topic tonight. And that topic is high blood pressure. High blood pressure. Hypertension, as the medical term is called. And we will be talking about that primarily this evening. Now, folks, this is very, very common, obviously, and many of you may have this. Many of you may have been battling this, and we're going to talk about this disorder as it relates to cardiovascular disease. You know, cardiovascular disease is the biggest killer in our country. And as bad as COVID has been, as bad as cancer is, we all know people, unfortunately, that have been affected by those disorders. Well, cardiovascular deaths are many, many more times common. And, you know, you can be obviously pretty symptomatic with the other two, but cardiovascular can creep up on you with no warning at all. And one of the things in our practice that we do now, which is different from a traditional medical practice, let me kind of talk about that for just a second as you get your friends to tune in to us talking about high blood pressure tonight. But one of the things that we do in our current practice that is different from a traditional practice is we spend time and we spend effort looking into things that are harder to find. But when we find them, we can do an action against them. We're finding all sorts of buildup in the arteries. One of my last patients that I was reviewing some studies on right before coming to the studio tonight is in his mid-30s. And we have detected some buildup in his arteries. But the good news is, you know, the bad news is there's plaque. But the good news is he's young and we can do something about it. But tonight we're going to be talking about high blood pressure. Now, you know, what is blood pressure? Well, we use, traditionally in the doctor's office, we use my stethoscope and a blood pressure cuff. Now, we'll get into different ways that you can measure blood pressure, but basically we're listening to the pulse wave of blood going through your arteries. Now, there's a measurement that we take when your heart is squeezing. It's an active squeeze. And that's the first number that we bring up, and that's called the systolic number. So that's the first number in the series, and then we have that little slash, and we have the second number. Now, the second number is the pressure when the heart is at rest within the artery system. And so we have looked at numbers over the years, and there are some of you that are older patients, you may be confused as to what is high blood pressure, because that definition has changed over the years. It really has. And so it sometimes can be very confusing. I remember when I was in my internship and residency training that we would say you take the person's age, add 100 to that, and if you're below that, you're fine. We would laugh at those figures now. But back then, the medical studies that we had were somewhat limited. We've grown in our understanding about blood pressure, and we've actually ratcheted the level down to what is considered high blood pressure. So let's talk for just a moment. What is a good normal blood pressure? And it's going to be a little bit based on age, but generally, you want 120 on that first number, below 120 and below 80 on the second number, the diastolic. Now, elevated blood pressure is between 120 and let's just say 130, it's easy to remember, 120, 130 on the first number, and still being less than 80 diastolic on the second number. That's somebody that is of interest. In other words, if you have a reading that's falling in there, that means that you could develop high blood pressure. You certainly don't want to transition into the high blood pressure numbers, but it's just telling you, uh-oh, you better watch out. You better take some action because your blood pressure is drifting. It may be drifting. Now, what is really high blood pressure? We look at two stages. We call them stages. Stage one is where that first number is 130 to, we'll just say 140 to round it off, 130 to 140. If you're in that range, you're in stage one high blood pressure. Stage two is above that. And then we look at the diastolic reading, stage one being 80 to, let's just say 90, 80 to 90, so in your 80s on that second number, and stage two is above that, above 90 and above. So what is the significance of high blood pressure? We've kind of defined it now for you, and these are current recommendations for using those definitions. What's the big deal about blood pressure? It's a number on a page, right? It's something that we hear. But it translates into very, very bad things that can happen to you. We look at cardiovascular things. We look at the heart. We look at contributing to heart attacks. We look at contributing to strokes. And kidney disease, oh my goodness, that's a big contributor to kidney disease. You certainly don't want to lose your kidney function. So it has a lot of ramifications. It grows plaque. You know, the things that we've been talking about the last couple of times we've been on air, we've been talking about plaque buildup. And it is one of the things that contributes to that. So, you know, this has ramifications. Heart failure. It has a number of different bad things that are associated with it. Now, you might wonder which number is the worst. I mean, you know, which one carries the most significance? Is it that front number, the systolic, or the back end number, the diastolic? Well, in order to answer your question, and that's a great question, by the way, it depends on your age. Studies have shown that it's kind of age dependent, and right around age 55, right in there, is where it kind of changes which one is the most significant. If you're younger than age 55, we look at the second number, the diastolic. We put a little more weight on what that is doing. If you're above age 55, we put more weight on the front number, the systolic number. So that's a great question to ask, and in just a little while we'll be taking callers to talk about that. You know, one of the things that has happened, and then one of the things that we love for our patients to do, is to take an active role in your own medical health. I mean, it's absolutely great. People are doing that. And, you know, really when you walk into the doctor's office, it's kind of nerve-wracking, isn't it? Now, in our practice, in our concierge practice, from the get-go, from you walking in the door, you know it's different. It's a different kind of place. It's a different kind of environment. You're not in there with dozens and dozens of other patients. It's very quiet. It's very calming. In fact, one of the great things I have to say, my staff is so good. We took an afternoon off a weekend ago, and we've got our Christmas decorations up. It's just absolutely, it's wonderful, it's soothing, it's calming. But, you know, that's the way the office is year-round. And you're not having to wait, getting worried, you know, in a traditional doctor's office. You may wait 30 minutes or more to see the doctor. And in our practice, you're here, you're there about 5 minutes before the nurse brings you back. So it's kind of a different environment, But no matter how good an environment it is, it's still artificial, isn't it? You're still a little nervous about that blood work we're going to go over or what we're going to talk about that day. You may be having struggles with dealing with something, and you know we're going to talk about it. So it's a little bit nerve-wracking. What does that do to your blood pressure? What do you think? It raises it. So we have to all remember that when you're in the doctor's office, it can go up. And, you know, there are some patients that get very fearful of this thing, the white coat. And in fact, we'll kind of joke about it after they're identified, after we identify them, and we'll say, hey, as soon as you pull into the parking lot, I bet your blood pressure's kind of going up a little bit. But one of the great things that's happened over the last bunch of years is the ability for you as patients to take an interest in your medical health. And you can actually have devices that are pretty reliable in terms of measuring your blood pressure. And, you know, we'll just talk about that briefly. I looked this up in a medical study of over 600 patients. And, you know, there are devices that you can get at your pharmacy that will measure blood pressure at the wrist. And they're very, very user friendly. Some of them will even tell you if you don't have your arm at the proper level. They'll beep when it's an improper test. But at any rate, we were talking about devices that can be utilized for measuring your blood pressure. And so the wrist measurement is easy. It's easy to do. Now, if you're using home equipment, what we recommend is that you cross-correlate it. In other words, bring it to your doctor's office, and we will go ahead and check it against our equipment. There's always going to be a little bit of variation, but basically what will happen is we'll tell you roughly what that fudge factor is. And these devices have gotten very, very accurate. So, you know, this is a great way for you to measure your blood pressure at home when you're calm, nothing's going on, and that's very, very helpful. In fact, a lot of the home readings have been shown to be more predictive and accurate in the long run. So, you know, it's wonderful to have that kind of information. So we would encourage you to do that. We talked about why this is important, why blood pressure is important. And for every 20 millimeters on that first number that it's raised above the normal range, the risk of death from heart disease and stroke doubles. It absolutely doubles. So that's very, very important to remember. We've talked about what's more important. We'll come back in just a moment and we'll talk about that.
To Ribeye Steakhouse in Nashville. Come on in and enjoy our legendary tender and juicy Omaha Angus ribeyes. And try and share our seafood entrees, your choice of shrimp, flounder, or oysters. And especially don't forget our famous salad bar with all your favorite fixins. If you want to give that someone special something to revel in, Ribeye's gift certificates can be made to order. And as you're looking for somewhere to host a business meeting or special event, you can reserve the Angus room. Ribeye Steakhouse of Nashville, over 10 years of great food.
Welcome to Davis Furniture Company in historical downtown Rocky Mount, where we treat our customers like family. We have 16,000 square feet of floor space for furniture and accessories to help make your house a home. For over 30 years, we've believed in offering quality furniture at the best prices with strong customer service. We also offer in-store financing, delivery, and something you won't find anywhere else. We truly love our customers. We pride ourselves in our relationship with you. Come by and see the Davis difference at Davis Furniture Company.
What makes Premier Equipment Company Premier? Our employees. People trained in the latest technology. People who love our customers and take pride in our products and service. People who love a job well done. With two locations to serve you in Enfield and Rocky Mount, we're easy to find and easy to do business with. Premier Service, Premier Parts, Premier Employees, Premier Equipment. Now selling Massey Ferguson at our Enfield location.
At Badcock Home Furniture and More, we're cherishing those we love and celebrating the place we call home at the Home for the Holiday Sale. Create a comfortable space to serve up style with savings of up to 50% on select items. Plus, our best mattress deals of the year. Top it all off with a free TV or adjustable base with select mattress purchase. All with no credit refused. So set the table and enjoy the little moments that mean the most this holiday season. For details, visit Badcock.com.
Whether you have knee, hip, or shoulder issues requiring joint repair or replacement, or you're dealing with chronic back pain, arthritis, or carpal tunnel, Nash UNC Healthcare can help you enjoy life again without all the pain. Here, you'll find the latest diagnostic technology and an award-winning medical team, one committed to your successful treatment and recovery. Comprehensive, compassionate, expert orthopedic care. It's all here at Nash UNC.
Today's the day to get a great...
Well, folks, welcome back. And I left you with a teaser at the end of the first segment. And the teaser was this. You know, if this is so common, which it is, for sure, what causes high blood pressure? And I'm ready for the big reveal. Here we go. Here's the big reveal. After multi-millions of dollars of research, many, many decades of research, the answer is, we don't know. Now, we know certain things that will raise blood pressure, but as to the actual cause at a cellular level, we just don't know right now. But I'm going to go through some things that are risk factors for developing high blood pressure, and for if they're not addressed, then they could lead to that. Age is one. You know, age. As we age, our arteries stiffen. That's the natural order of events. Unless you're taking supplements that can counteract that, you're going to age, and you're going to have stiffer arteries. I call it your pipes. Your pipes will get stiffer. As that happens through physics, your blood pressure within that system goes up. So that is something that happens with time and age. Overweight, being overweight, definitely can raise blood pressure. Now, a family history is something you can't do anything about, but if you do have a family history where people have high blood pressure, you yourself will be at higher risk. So that's something to think about. By the way, you see the number at the bottom of the screen? Please feel free to call in, and we'll be taking those calls along the way. Race, you know, ethnicity plays a role. In the African American community, high blood pressure seems to occur earlier in life. It seems to be more severe when it does occur, and the end organ damage seems to be worse. When we say end organ damage, that means kidney function, losing kidney function, the heart, losing heart muscle function, and so forth. You know, if you have a kidney challenge where your kidneys are not functioning as well as they should, and you have kidney impairment, it will tend to raise your blood pressure. A high sodium diet, and what do you mean by sodium? We mean salt. And folks, it's in our culture. It's baked in, if you want to use that little pun, but it really is. You know, what I say to folks is this. If you're not in the kitchen cooking it, you don't know how much salt the cook is putting in there, okay? And we'll come back to that in just a moment. Excessive alcohol consumption definitely can raise blood pressure. Physical inactivity, you know, even our kids nowadays, you know, everybody's playing on the computer, they're playing with their phone. People are just not very physically active. In our society, most people have cars, they have transportation. So that inactivity can actually be a risk factor for high blood pressure. Let's talk a little bit about treatment. And you may think that we're going to just be talking about pills. Let's not talk about pills quite yet, okay? Let's talk about non-pharmacologic treatment for blood pressure, because it can have a big, big role. And again, within our practice at MDVIP, we have time. You know, that's another thing that's different from a regular practice. In a regular practice, and believe me, I was the founder of a regular practice and been in that for over 35 years. You know, there's a time crunch, the time crunch that the provider has with you and the time crunch that you have with them. It gets down to you generally waiting longer to see the provider than you have with the provider. But in our MDVIP practice, you'll have plenty of time, and we will discuss the ins and outs of things. We'll have time to talk about non-pharmacologic modalities. So let's talk about that for just a second. We talked about how sodium can raise blood pressure. Well, just the reverse of that can happen. Moderate sodium restriction can reduce blood pressure by 5 points on that first number. Now, that could be a big deal for you, reducing it 5 points. Now, how are you going to know whether you have high sodium? You know, the apps on our phones now, the computer, you can go to your favorite restaurant, and most of the restaurants have nutritional breakdowns, and you can actually pre-plan your meal. I've done this with patients in the office because we have time to do this. We've just picked up their favorite restaurant, and we've made a make-believe menu of what they would order, but then we've looked at alternatives to their favorite order. And believe it or not, we've been able to cut their sodium down tremendously just by making proper choices. So that's a big deal, folks. And you can go to your favorite restaurant, your favorite fast food place, and one biscuit can be 1,500 milligrams of sodium. And if you're trying to keep below 2,500 to 3,000 a day, that's half your sodium intake in 10 minutes.
We have a question.
Sure.
What symptoms would someone have if they have high blood pressure and they've never had their blood pressure taken? What symptoms
okay.
may they have?
All right, great question. So the question is, what kind of symptoms, especially if you haven't been going to the doctor recently, and you don't have your own equipment, what symptoms could a person have? And the scary thing is, unless your blood pressure is extremely high, remember those numbers we talked about, your blood pressure might have to be over 180, over 190, over 200 on that first number to have any symptoms at all. You might have some headache, you might have some nosebleeds, but honestly, and this is the scary part with high blood pressure, sometimes you have absolutely no symptoms. And remember, those cut points where you can run into problem are way below where you would cause symptoms. So great question. And this is why, you know, getting your blood pressure checked, you know, again, with these home monitors, they can be very, very helpful to have at home for you to check your own blood pressure. But that's a great question. So unfortunately, a lot of times, no symptoms at all. I've had many patients through the years who we just picked up because they were coming into the doctor's office. A blood pressure is routine. You know, we check it on a routine basis because we know blood pressure is dynamic. It fluctuates. And you'll never know if you don't check, right? And that's another thing in our practice. We're doing checks not just on blood pressure, but on other things. And I call it the ticking bomb. Because of the way this practice is structured, we're looking for things that have no symptoms currently. Again, we're detecting things early enough to intervene before the bomb goes off. Let's talk about weight loss, you know, and in a future event here on TV, probably in January, we'll be talking about weight loss. But did you know that for every pound you lose, that your blood pressure may go down 1 point? So think about that. 10 pounds, 10 points on your blood pressure readings, that's a huge difference. That's a huge drop. And again, we're talking about no medication. We're talking about lifestyle. Now, I'm not saying that it's an easy road to go. Losing weight is hard, and keeping it off is even more difficult. But it's worth the challenge. It's worth looking at. It's worth talking over with your physician. And last month, you remember, we talked about different strategies that can help you lose weight. The DASH diet is high in vegetables, fruits, low-fat dairy products, whole grains, poultry, fish, nuts. But that combination diet has been shown to lower blood pressure. So that's something that your physician, your provider may speak with you about. Now, we talked about inactivity being a risk factor for high blood pressure, but you know, exercise can also drop your blood pressure readings. Aerobic is what we talk about in terms of walking or getting on a stationary bike or an outdoor bike or an elliptical trainer. That's what we call an aerobic form of exercise. Even resistance training, that's with weights and bands. We believe that those forms of exercise reduce the resistance within the arteries over time, and it can reduce it by 5 points on the systolic, 3 points on the diastolic. So again, you see what we're talking about. In doing these incremental things, your potential to lower your blood pressure is really immense. Now, alcohol, we mentioned that briefly, but if you're kind of trying to roadmap this thing, males, because of their increased body mass and weight generally, you shouldn't be having more than 2 alcoholic beverages or equivalents a day, women no more than 1. So again, these are things that have nothing to do with a prescription approach, okay? But they can significantly lower your blood pressure and thereby lower your risk for bad things happening. Well, I know sooner or later you're going to ask, well, what about medications? And medications obviously have been studied. They're cleared by the FDA and approved for treatment of blood pressure. What's been shown with proper pharmacologic usage of medicine to reduce blood pressure to appropriate levels? 50% reductions in heart failure. 50. 30 to 40% reductions in stroke. 20 to 25% reductions in heart attacks. One of the more recent studies showed that if a provider treats 100 patients for their blood pressure over a 4 to 5 year period, and you can get people to their goal, you'll reduce cardiovascular events, strokes, heart attacks, heart failure, by 2 cases over that 4 to 5 years. So, and the benefits for that may be even greater in our older population of patients.
We have a caller that says that her blood pressure is too low. She said, how low is too low?
Okay, very good question. It's just kind of the opposite. Typically, we like the systolic to be no lower than 100. So if your blood pressure is consistently lower than 100, If you have lived there all your life, so to speak, and you're without symptoms, you just have a very, very low blood pressure. But typically, you know, we get a little concerned why it's low if it's below 100. So in rare cases, we'll allow it to be in that range. But people with severe heart failure, sometimes it's very difficult for them to raise their blood pressure in above 100. But typically, we like it 100, over 100. So that normal range in the 100, 110 range, that's really a great blood pressure. But very good question. You know, and sometimes this comes up, folks that are treated for high blood pressure. I'll give you an example recently within my concierge practice. I've had a fellow who I've known for a long time. He had some kidney challenges because of his blood pressure, and we had him on medication for quite some number of years. He started doing what we talked about last time, the intermittent fasting, and we had talked to him about it, explained how that could work. He's now lost close to 30 pounds, and guess what? He was starting to have symptoms of feeling lightheaded. And what we found was, as he's losing weight, his need for medication has been drastically reduced. And we've been able to drop his medication several times now. So it's the wonderful, wonderful thing that doctors don't get to do a whole lot. Sometimes we're adding medicines. So in this case, we were able to realize that his blood pressure was starting to lower too much because of his tremendous lifestyle intervention. So that can happen, and that needs to be tracked. Again, it's really helpful to have those home blood pressure readings. If you start to see them falling way, way low, then it's something you can inform your medical team about. Okay. You know, being treated. You know, when a doctor chooses to use medication because we can't get the blood pressure down for whatever reasons, usually don't be surprised if you end up being on a couple of blood pressure medicines. It's not unusual. This is very, very common because our goals in trying to get that blood pressure down, generally we're shooting for below 130 over 80. That's our goal. Wherever you started from, we're trying to get you below 130 over 80. There may be some very unusual circumstances where we'll let it be above that. But typically, that's what we're trying to do. Don't be surprised if we want to see you more frequently, because we know it's imperative to get that blood pressure down fairly quickly. You know, again, in our practice, I'll speak to our practice, I can get you in same day even, or same week, and we can repeat that over a period of time. All righty. Reasons for not reaching your goals. You know, I'd always look at your pharmacologic, you know, am I taking my medicine? Am I taking it regularly? You know, that can be a problem. Sometimes it's a problem with cost. I would really, really encourage you, look at your sodium intake. Look at your sodium intake. And we see this happen all the time. People may not eat out except once a week, but in that day or two following eating out, their blood pressures may go up because they had tremendous salt load during eating out. Lack of exercise, too much alcohol. So am I gaining weight? If I'm gaining weight, that may make it very, very hard for me to lose, to lower my blood pressure. So, you know, this is an important topic. It unfortunately often doesn't cause symptoms. You have to have this tracked by your medical team, but you can take a big role in this yourselves, a huge role. Please, if you're interested in our practice and the uniqueness of our practice, you see the email there that you can send to Bridget Pridgen, my office manager and one of my certified medical assistants. We look forward to hearing from you and engaging you. If you want to just come in and talk about the practice, please feel free to schedule a consultation with me. I'd be more than happy. You know, this is an exciting thing that we're doing. We're again detecting disease early enough to make a difference in people's lives. And it's just, it's fascinating, it's wonderful.
The smells of the season are in the air. Get into the holiday spirit and stop by Drummond's Florist and Gifts and let Sue, Renee, or Brenda help you with all your decorating needs. Floral arrangements, wreaths, candles, and decorations. Renee can even decorate your Christmas tree for you. Drummond's is your one-stop shop for your Christmas decorating needs. And don't forget to say hello to Bella when you stop by. Drummond's Florist and Gifts at 3689 Dorchess Boulevard, or call them at 252-442-6110.
At Badcock Home Furniture and More, we're cherishing those we love and celebrating the place we call home at the Home for the Holiday Sale. Create a comfortable space to serve up style with savings of up to 50% on select items, plus our best mattress deals of the year. Top it all off with a free TV or adjustable base with select mattress purchase, all with no credit refused. So set the table and enjoy the little moments that mean the most this holiday season. For details, visit Badcock.com.
Full aspirin, over-the-counter medications and such a day, and we can get you to stop doing that and actually fix the problem so the headaches don't rise anymore. A lot of people think chiropractic hurts. It does not. Most of the people come in and they feel great when they leave.
I was playing flag football with a bunch of childhood friends, and we live in the glory days, and I felt the pop. I wound up tearing my quadriceps tendon. The MRI took place, and then it was like, you really need surgery. Surgical repair is the only way to fix it. After surgery, of course, there was the rehab phase, and it was a breeze. It really was worth it. To do it here with a qualified and exceptional team, this was the best place that I could have chosen, and it's right here in Rocky Mount. I was treated like a rock star.
Day to get a great deal on a new Toyota from Rocky Mount Toyota during the Today's the Day sales event. Like a brand new 2021 Corolla, lease for just $159 a month. Or lease a new 2020 Camry for only $179 a month. Plus, every new vehicle comes with our lifetime warranty.
Enjoy every bit of your new car purchase with great deals, a ride you'll love, and service to match. Visit us today or shop RockyMountToyota.com.
Welcome back. You know, this is an amazing, amazing thing. You know, we've got bonus time. We've got bonus time. So there is still time over the next 10 or so minutes for you to call in. please call the number at the bottom of the screen. You're going to see it flash up there in just a moment. There you go. 446-6161. 446-6161. And we'll answer your questions. You know, one question came in during the break, and it was something like this. There are blood pressure monitors in the pharmacies. And, you know, how can I utilize that as a patient? And, you know, if I get different readings maybe there versus the doctor's office. You know, anytime I believe that you can have input into your health and utilizing a device that helps give you information. Because remember, we talked about the fact that you can have elevated blood pressure that is not healthy at all and have absolutely no symptoms. So you really need, in this case, to be able to monitor it somehow. You know, again, I think using a device in the pharmacy is better than not using anything because it gives you information. Personally, I really recommend people trying to get something for home use. So in your pharmacy, you can ask your pharmacist for a home monitoring device. Now, I particularly favor the wrist monitors, and I'll tell you why, because they've correlated between arm and wrist. And unless you are have problems with your circulation where you have peripheral, what we call peripheral vascular disease, the match between the wrist and the arm is very, very good. Putting an arm cuff on is sometimes very cumbersome. It's difficult. You know, I think about some of my patients that are solo, and, you know, they don't have someone there to help them all the time place it on properly on the arm, whereas the wrist is very easy to get to. So I really like that. Again, we're talking about at the low end, you can probably spend in the $30, $40, $45 range. If you want to get the one with all the bells and whistles, a monitor that has, you know, two different people can be using the same monitor, it's maybe in the $70, $80 range. Remember, folks, this is going to give you an insight into your health. And really, these numbers are wonderful to use. And, you know, the first time you've bought one, take it in when you're going to your doctor, and we can, again, correlate it against our readings in the office and tell you about how much it might be offset by. But that's a great question. Great question. We're open line here, so please feel free to call. And if you have a question about MDVIP, you can call about that as well. You know, one of the challenges in medication compliance is staying with it. And you know, one of the things I've seen over the years is somebody gets a really good blood pressure reading and, oh, well, maybe I can come off my medications. And that's something to work with your healthcare provider on. As I mentioned earlier, if you're doing lifestyle interventions along the way, and we've mentioned what some of those could be, that's a great segue into discussing, let's look at seriously cutting back on your medication. You know, and I think it's a wonderful partnership to have with your physician and to take the time and the effort to go through that with you. Again, I think we have a lot of helps out there. Some of the apps on your phone will have an ability to scout out your sodium content. And that's, again, one of the big factors that we see contributing towards elevated blood pressure. So, you know, it's the return on investment for keeping control of your blood pressure is immense, and it's really something to really strive after. Do we have any other calls? Come on, folks. This is your chance to talk to me this evening, live. You know, the ramifications of high blood pressure, what are some of the things, if we find out that you have high blood pressure and you've never been told that before, A lot of times, if it's in the lower range, in the stage one, or certainly pre-hypertension that we talked about earlier, we'll probably recommend some things, some non-pharmacologic things for you to try, and then we'll closely have you come back and monitor this situation. You know, we don't like it to go on and on and on forever because it can cause issues. You know, we try to ascertain how long you've had the high blood pressure. You know, it can be something that people have on and off throughout the years, but there's no point in just putting our heads in the sand and ignoring it. That's the worst thing that we can do, both as a physician and as a patient. So take this seriously. It is a serious thing, but again, with the interventions that we can bring to bear on this thing, it's something that we can control together, working together on this. You know, let your doctor and your medical team know whether you are having problems with your medications. You know, there can be side effects to medications. You know, there's one of the classes of medicines that we use to treat high blood pressure, in a small percentage of people, can actually cause something as crazy as a cough. Now, nowadays with cough, we think COVID, right? But if you've just started a blood pressure medicine and it happens to be in this class, you know, it may, fortunately, it may not be COVID. It may be related to the blood pressure medicine. And that's something that you discuss with your physician team and bring to bear, because that's something that we can definitely do something about. You know, the great thing is, as opposed to 30, 40 years ago, we have multiple medications. You know, I liken it to somebody who's allergic to penicillin. You know, if you need an antibiotic but you're allergic to penicillin, do we just say, well, tough luck, I guess you might succumb to this infection? No. We say, well, fortunately, there are other choices that we can choose. And it's that way with blood pressure medication as well. So, you know, all is not lost. We try to modify things based according to what's going on in your body. And so, again, at your follow-up visits, we need to know these things. So it's good. That dialogue is very, very, very powerful. And having time to speak, you know, in a non-hurried fashion with your physician team is priceless. And honestly, folks, that's one of the things that drew me to the MDVIP concept, was having time for you to engage with us and with me. You know, I love teaching, and it just provides that format for us to do that in an unhurried modality. So it's really a different kind of practice that we enjoy so much. So again, if things have been disappointing for you, the way that modern medicine has gone, really take a look at what we offer. We offer something that's different, something that is different in our area. You know, good physicians and good extenders are pressed because of the time. The time element is difficult on everybody in the healthcare system. And it's unique that when you have time to talk and sit down, so much can happen that's in a positive sense. So we would encourage you to engage us. I do consultations in the office. If you're interested in the MDVIP concept, please feel free to reach out to Bridget Pridgen at that email, and you can see 451-7043. 451-7043 is our office number as well. So we've got the holidays coming up. We're excited, and I will be back next month again to talk about some very sweet things. So stay tuned. Have your folks, your friends, neighbors tune in, because again, it's going to be talking about a very, very common medical challenge that many of you have, and you'll want to pay attention to that. So thank you again for your attention this evening, and we look forward to engaging with you again. This is Dr. Richard Michal, MDVIP, signing off. Have a good evening.